this is one of their mobile kitchens that they actually...
is that even some, what I call habitual...
beautiful stop and shop in the Wilton... penalty, but it was actually a tax, and that it... Absolutely. What's the name of the show?
Welcome to the Marty Heiser Show. I'm your host, Marty Heiser, and I'll be your host for the next hour. So welcome. Hey, it's great to have you here. We've been playing reruns the past couple weeks, but we are here in living color. You know how I can tell we're here in living color? Because this country continues to disintegrate before your very eyes. Whether it's the IRS that is claiming, I mean, you really can't make this stuff up. They're claiming, those emails that you wanted, we had a little computer glitch. I know you asked for them 13 months ago, and we really haven't gotten back to you, but it's kind of a modified, the dog ate my homework. That's what's going on. Iraq is coming unglued. This, if we're nice to them, they'll be nice to us. If we just go to Egypt and give a speech and say, oh, I know, there have been many, many sins in the past in the United States, and do you know, my name's Barack Obama. It sounds kind of Middle Eastern and mysterious. I'm just like you. Everything's gonna be fine, because after all, these mean, nasty terrorists, they weren't really bloodthirsty barbarians. No, they were a little like us. They just didn't like George W. Bush, because he was mean, and he had that nasty camp at Gitmo. And if we just get rid of the camp, all these terrorists will just like us, they'll understand us, we'll be inclusive, everything's gonna be great. Well, how's this limp-wristed foreign policy working out for everyone? I'll tell you, if you're in Iraq, and heaven forbid you're a Christian, it's not working out too good. The IRS has 89,500 employees. You know how I know? I Googled it. That's how I know. And there were six of those employees that the United States Congress wanted to ask about the targeting of our fellow citizens for their political views. Oh, no. We're not talking about 1950s Soviet Union, Brezhnev, Big Brother is watching. No. We're talking about progressive, led by liberal Democrats, the United States, where you're allowed to speak your mind and there's freedom of the press come what may. That's who we're talking about, where the federal government in the IRS targets your fellow citizens. Why? Because of their political views. There's 89,500 employees in the IRS. The Congress wanted to talk to six of them and see what their emails had to say about all this nonsense that's been going on. One of them, of course, is our good friend Lois Lerner. You know, I print up these pictures of people off the internet, and this Lois Lerner one, I just can't seem to get rid of. I know, there's some water stains on it. It's a low-budget show here. Lois Lerner, guess what? Sorry, Dad. My computer crashed. Yeah, that's it. The computer crashed. It's all gone. Can't give you all those emails where we're talking to the White House and they're talking about, oh, yeah, listen, we got to go after those in this off-year election. We got to go after those tea parties. Nope, can't do that. Then we go to this one. I love the names. It's almost like they make them up. Nicole Flack. You want a little flack? Here you go. That's Nicole Flack. That's another one they wanted to see the emails just to make sure everything's okay. Oh, gee, sorry, Dad. Yeah, computer crashed. Well, gosh, little girl, there's a hard drive, isn't there? Huh, darndest thing. You know that hard drive? We went ahead and took the hard drive and erased it and cleaned it, and then we threw it out in the trash. There's no way to check. Sorry. Oh, but don't you worry, my fellow Americans, because Barack Obama, as he said on TV, is upset by this IRS scandal, and he's gonna get after it. He's frustrated. He's as mad as you are. He's just can't believe what he read in the paper. It's terrible. I can't believe it. You're kidding. The emails were lost? Why, that's incredible. And you know what Barack Obama does? He's gonna send out his buddy, Eric Holder. There's his buddy, Eric Holder. Don't you worry about the thing, because old contempt of Congress himself, the highest law enforcement person in the entire country, is going to get to the bottom of this. Don't you worry. He's on the job. You really got to ask yourself, are we a country of laws, or are we a country of an absolutely non-constitutional runaway federal government that doesn't give a damn about the law, doesn't give a damn about the constitutional rights of your fellow citizens, and they're just running roughshod? And if you believe for a minute Lois Lerner, Miss, under advice of counsel, I plead the fifth, but I did nothing wrong, and oh yeah, all my emails are gone. If you buy that load of stuff, you're just not being honest. Look, I know. We're in the Northeast. We're all liberals here. Everybody voted for Barack Obama, not once, but twice. I know. And it's a little unnerving when you come to find out that the guy that's running your country is corrupt and he's going after your fellow citizens. You know, I think they said it best. When they came for the socialists, I didn't speak out because I wasn't a socialist. When they came for the trade unionist, I didn't speak out because I wasn't a trade unionist. When they came for the Jews, I didn't speak out because I wasn't a Jew. But then they came for me, and there was no one left to speak for me. Maybe the Tea Party isn't your cup of tea. Maybe you don't agree with this whole adherence to the Constitution, wanting to limit government oversight. Maybe you think they're a little wacky. I've got a guy on the studio tonight, and you can judge for yourself. But these are your fellow Americans, and they're getting crushed by the IRS targeting them. And the IRS, when they're called to account, is telling the entire United States, we lost the emails. What are you going to do about it? Well, we're going to see. We're going to see what this United States is all about. Are we a country of laws? Are we a country of really cool, hip presidents that can just get away with whatever they want because we don't care? That's the thought for tonight. Bob Macguffie.
Indeed.
You're the founder of Right Principles. You've been involved with this. I thought it was supposed to be dead, Tea Party movement. And I appreciate you very much coming on the show.
Well, thanks for
We're joined as well by Jim Bellano,
Marty,
adjunct professor and, man about town. And Dave Streit, soon to be the host of a new television show called Straight Talk. Is that in the
office? One would hope.
Well, I understand it's still in negotiations. You're wanting that fifth year.
Yeah,
right?
My people are talking to their people.
Okay. Dave Streit is joining us as well. All right. I vented a little bit, but where am I wrong? What do you think's going on with the targeting of the Tea Party, and now when they're called to account, they have the unmitigated gall to say, oh, sorry, the dog ate my homework, and people are buying it.
Well, that's exactly what they're saying. They are targeting the Tea Party, and it's one of these deals where you're supposed to believe me or your lying eyes. It's been going on. I know Tea Party people that have waited several years to get their 501c4s approved. And to be clear, and there's a lot of propaganda going on, a lot of false statements about this, a 501c4, which is what most of the Tea Parties are trying to do, it's just a classification. So there's nothing really much tax-exempt about it. Contributions to it are not tax-exempt. The only thing that's tax-exempt if you were to earn any interest on the account. 501c3s are charitables. So all it is an approval of a name and a formation of the organization so you can get a bank account. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you have to form a corporation, mm-hmm. and any contributions would be like revenue and would be taxed, which is crazy. So there was no advantage being sought. Liberal groups have been doing it for years and all the rest. And they clearly singled out the conservatives, and they just strung out and asked endless questions to hold him up. And all the evidence is in the emails, and you know, now they're conveniently supposed to be lost. But I would think that ISA will go after him, you know, with subpoenas to everybody that she was corresponding with, and ultimately get a lot of it.
But you think we'll be able to?
We should. We should.
The White House, as you know, glibly said, sorry to disappoint.
Yeah.
No smoking gun here. Nudge, nudge, wink, wink. Know what I mean? They think it's a big joke.
Well, they run out the clock is their main game with everything. They slow walk everything, slow it down. You know, Clinton showed them how to do that, and they do it on steroids here. And it's difficult. It's difficult because, you know, the gears grind slowly as it is. And so if you're going to slow walk it, they'll be out of office by time.
So why did David Bratt win?
Why did Dave? Whoa, shifting gears.
Good question.
Well,
just to bring everyone up to speed, because we're going. Because you're like the new big man on campus.
He's the Tea Party aficionado.
You're the guy. You're the guy who basically what you're talking about is the Virginia race, and he beat out Cantor, who was a majority whip in the House.
He was 37% ahead in the polls 4 weeks ahead of the election. 37% ahead, he got blown out by 12%. Yeah. Unprecedented in American history.
By David Brett, a college professor, a veritable neophyte.
A Christian.
Oh,
my God. Who knows his stuff
what happened,
and stayed on message? Well, it turns out that David Brett knows his economics, and he really kept largely with an economic message. Mm-hmm. But Eric Cantor was an arrogant man. He was a poor candidate. He had been too involved in the Washington scene, and the Republicans were starting to see that in the district, and Brett came along and was very much encouraged to run, and was helped by the grassroots and by talk radio people that came in, because he was number one. He's a good candidate. He could message. He was a credible candidate, and he had something to say. And Cantor had painted himself into a very poor position, and he wasn't a likable guy among many other traits that a politician ought to have, and he was an arrogant man. And well, he lost, and
they
it
all are, and they all win.
Yeah.
Right? Well, Blumenthal, have you ever met a more arrogant person? Jim Himes, a more arrogant person? They win.
And it shows.
So it wasn't arrogance. What it was immigration, right?
Well, that was
a
final issue. But it was a broader picture than that.
Remember, Republicans are the party of states' rights, small government, things at the local level. Democrats like their Washingtonians to be big people. Oh, we're the Speaker of the House. We get more stuff. We get more pork. Oh, I want Hillary Clinton to move here for 6 months so she could be my senator. You know, they're big on big names. But immigration was an issue. But he also, a lot of polls showed, he alienated the district. He was never there. Yeah. He wasn't there on election day.
He wasn't at the polls.
He's a classic Washington creature.
And that doesn't sit well with the Republicans.
He's a corporatist. And all he was concerned with was raising funds from corporations and financial companies. And that's who he was loyal to. And they all get that way. Himes is like that. Himes is another corporatist. They raise the money from the corporations, and then they start to represent the political class back to us. They represent Washington back to us instead of us to Washington. It's horrendous.
And I think Chris Matthews had the comment of the week when he said, when he was on an interview, and he said, I think the Democrats have to reinvent their message. They can't continue to try and paint the people in the Tea Party as ignorant, uninformed, unintelligent people. Have you listened to David Brett? Chris Matthews said, I've listened to David Brett. He's articulate. He's clear thinking. He's well educated. He's likable. He knows his facts. That's the face of the Tea Party, and that's what you got to get used to now.
Yeah, it's amazing that Matthews would say that.
It was unbelievable.
Matthews the guy that said, when I hear Barack Obama's speech, I get this tingly feeling coming up my leg?
He's been bucking the trend the last week or two. There.
Really?
On the show.
Yeah. Wow. Well, he has a moment of lucidity.
He was ticked off about Bergdahl. He was ticked off about, I haven't heard about the emails, but the Bergdahl thing ticked him off.
I mean, this email thing, I mean, if you're a self-respecting Democrat and you have any intelligence whatsoever.
Isn't that kind of an oxymoron, though?
It's got to be a little embarrassing with this whole, oh, I'm sorry, gosh, our computer crashed, and oh yeah, the other six people you wanted out of 800 or 89,500 employees, the other six you wanted to talk to, guess what, all their computers crashed too, and oh, hard drives, oh, we threw them away. I mean, really.
But if
come
you
on
were, if
I
you
mean,
were
just I know. Don't talk among your liberal friends. We're just talking here. Not that many people watch the show. But really? I mean, come on. Really?
If you were a defender early on, you were a Democrat, and you said, okay, this is ridiculous. This is a stirred up controversy.
Oh, yeah.
It's just a mistake.
If
you follow the timeline, it was rogue agents in Cincinnati. Oops.
Yeah.
Then there was a connection to Washington. Mm-hmm. Then Lois Lerner takes the fifth.
Yeah.
Right? Then we go on. Then there's communication in the administration with White House people.
Yeah.
Then we go further. Then they lose the the emails. They go on and on. And every little piece, if you look at the timeline, if you're halfway objective, you have to say this. And really, if Obama was nonpartisan, he's supposed to, he's always blaming the other side.
I'm outraged by this. We're going to get to the bottom of this.
He'd appoint a special prosecutor. Yeah, he'd have Holder appoint a special prosecutor. That's the only way to do it.
Yeah. Well,
that's not going to happen.
Eric Holder? It's a joke.
He'd be putting a prosecutor on his own case. We come right back to him.
But why is there even a hint of surprise when you see this type of misconduct in office by anybody? We sit here and we say, eventually the left is going to wake up and see the hypocrisy and the lies and deceit. This is the party of, it depends on your definition of is. Oral sex isn't sex. It's really not my voice on that tape with Jennifer Flowers. And every time you turn around, he has another disclaimer that everybody says, oh, okay, that works. So when it comes time to saying, hey, the hard drive just kind of melted down and they were lost, everybody can say, oh, that makes perfect sense. They can accept that.
Stuff happens.
Yeah.
Not printing out of the email, not retrieving the emails, getting rid of the hard drives, wiping them off and destroying them. That they may have broken federal law. They may be in a box on those.
Basically,
well, they say the regulation is that they've got to keep those, and they have to be backed up. And if they weren't backed up, then they
I believe it's called obstruction of justice is what it's called, and destruction of evidence.
Nah.
Those are federal crimes. I mean, Richard Nixon was impeached because of 18 minutes that were missing on a tape that was subpoenaed. 18 seconds.
It was 18 seconds.
Yeah. The secretary hit the wrong button.
Yeah, she could, whatever it was. But this is like 2 years of lost emails. I'm still hopeful that there's a 13-year-old out there sucking down a can of Red Bull right now, and your government needs you, son. Put the Red Bull down and get those emails. I know you can, what do they call it, hack in something. You can do it. And I'd say, wait, where's that guy? He's in Russia. Snowden, right?
Snowden, do us a solid here.
Okay, all right, the whole thing, come on back, recreate
find
all
the emails,
these,
baby.
Find emails, all's forgiven, and we'll go on from there.
Keep in mind, we're dealing with the party of I smoked, but I didn't inhale.
I smoked, but I didn't inhale. I mean the suspension of logic to just believe all these excuses that are coming down the pike are really, quite ridiculous. Benghazi, that dastardly guy that did the video, that's what happened there. Why, Al-Qaeda's on the run, don't you know? And don't avoid your television screens and the fact that Iraq and Syria are up in arms and it's all Al-Qaeda and they're black flags and they're cutting people's heads off.
Well, see,
No, don't you worry. You're loving. Let's bring the two together. Kumbaya, faculty lounge, president has got this all under control. And the fact that he doesn't show strength on the international scene, he doesn't show strength when Russia plays him like a puppet, and Putin goes in and takes Crimea. He doesn't show strength when he says that people are being gassed in Syria, and I'm gonna fire off a missile, and two people disagree with him. So much for the red line. I'm backing out. You don't think that negative, evil people, operators in the world see that? You don't think that nature abhors a vacuum, and that's exactly what we got going on here? You don't think it's ridiculous when you have one deserter from the United States, and you basically give them the all the leaders of the military, the Taliban, in exchange for that? You don't think there's calculations going on? I mean, it's a very, very dangerous world when you have a president that has mushy thinking and doesn't have a backbone. You may not have liked George W. Bush, but one thing you knew, his word was his bond, and he wasn't going to shrink away from his responsibility. And the fact is, many Americans died in Iraq, died to get that country as normal as it possibly can be. And it was. It's only when we show weakness and project weakness that this happens. It's a bad situation. It's a bad situation on the domestic front. It's a bad situation on the international front. We need some change. And maybe these Tea Party guys might have some ideas. I know, you can tiss-tiss if you want, but there could be something there. There could be something there. Because what we got now, it ain't working. It ain't working.
So should we talk about what's going on in the Middle East right now? In Iraq?
Yeah.
I'd like to refer to our constitutional scholar here.
But the libertarian strain, I mean, you may agree with this, is that, is it such a bad thing? Obviously, to see what was all our gains being lost is terrible.
But what, with the loss of life. Gains? What were the gains?
Well, here, that's what I'm saying.
Fallujah.
Wait.
I mean, how many men died, you know, trying to subdue that one city, Fallujah? It was some of the most brutal combat.
What I'm saying is, as we move forward, and we got to get a handle on this, on the libertarian side, if the biggest threat to the United States is fundamentalist Islam,
yeah,
right, terrorism, fundamentalist Islam, and right now, the fundamentalist Sunnis are going after the fundamentalist Shia, why are we getting involved?
Because
maybe we want them to fight it out.
Well, you'll have
Iraq should be tripartite.
Well, if the end game is that the terrorists and Al Qaeda end up with an industrial state that they control, that's the danger.
They're doing pretty well right now. they're pretty funny. They're in control of Libya.
It's not the same. And Libya is a problem because it is more industrial. Certainly Afghanistan is just nothing but an anthill, right. But Iraq is a real country with an industrial base and the capability to probably produce a nuclear weapon, even as far as that. So,
well, think about this.
That's the danger there, right? And if we would have left U.S. forces there, these guys never would have been encouraged to come charging down the road toward Baghdad.
The news story that I just got a kick out of before I walked in tonight, about 7 o'clock, I'm sitting there watching, CNN or CNBC or one of the really liberal media outlets, and they said, breaking news, chemical weapons site in Iraq has been overrun by this ISIS. And I thought, chemical weapons site? Weren't we looking all over for that last time in the last war? And this ISIS group just found it? Oh, so they did have weapons of mass destruction. But think about it, the bigger picture. Think about what's going on over there. You had Kerry 4 months, 5 months ago say, you know what, we're going to drop all sanctions against Iran, and that'll really work out really well for us. Well, he's kind of looking like a genius today, because now we need Iran to try and counter Iraq. These are the strangest bedfellows I've ever seen.
But that army we left in Iraq, the Iraqi army, is almost a million-man army. Mm-hmm. And they're dropping their guns in front of these guys and fleeing. Why? Because most of them are Sunni. And the Maliki government is a Shia government. Yeah. And they've excluded all of these people.
That's correct.
So there's centuries of hatred between them, too. Yeah. We're not the policemen of the world. We're not going to fix that.
Do you agree with what I said, though, that if we had a stronger, more robust posture towards this, that it wouldn't allow this vacuum to be created in which these evil operators could function? Or is that naive on my part?
Well, you could essentially say that if we had never kicked out Saddam Hussein, you'd probably have a much more stable state in Iraq.
Ron Paul talks about this all the time, though. Ron Paul talks about blowback. And he's exactly right. Why did we have the Iranian hostage crisis and the Shah of Iran crisis? Because 26 years prior, we put the Shah in office, and we pissed off a lot of people over there. Mm-hmm. So the reality is, you know, my idea, and I've told you this 1,000 times, mm-hmm. my idea of defending the troops is, and supporting the troops is, get them home and out of harm's way. Think about this. If your son died in Afghanistan, how would you feel?
Bad.
Worse than bad. A complete waste. How do you think everybody that had loved ones that died in Vietnam felt? Like, it was a complete waste, right? The second we pulled out.
I would disagree with that, but go ahead.
Yeah, but you'd be wrong. No, go ahead. Well, tell me where I'm wrong.
Those gains could have been held. You know, Vietnam, they negotiated down to the truce on the 17th parallel, and that was the most that we were going to get, and that was successfully accomplished, right? And they were and the North and the Viet Cong were held North. And what happened? They challenged and probed in 1975, and the Democrats in Congress refused to put money in to the South to support and hold them back, and they just let them overrun the place.
Our troops left in 73, though.
Yeah, they did. They did, but you still, if you've stabilized a country, and if you're finished, you still have to have some influence in there to hold it together, the way we did in Korea, and the way we did in Japan and Germany after World War II. As much as you hate to leave a garrison behind, but that's what it takes. And they wouldn't support it in Vietnam, and the whole thing came tumbling down, and maybe didn't have to. And now they didn't do it in Iraq, and the same story. It's pretty tragic.
Maybe we should get out of the business of war.
Yeah, well.
Well, that would be nice if we lived in that place. But my point on losing a son in Vietnam or Afghanistan or Iraq, I think there were larger principles being fought out there in the Cold War in Vietnam. That I think Vietnam was, we were fighting against a totalitarian state, and that was Soviet communism, which was expanding. And I think that's a noble cause to fight against. In the case of Afghanistan and then Iraq, I think that our country was attacked. Our country was attacked by Islamic terrorists. And where they came from, the Bush doctrine was there would be no safe haven.
Right, they came from Saudi Arabia.
Okay, they were Saudi Arabians, but they were training and welcomed in Afghanistan where they came from. You could say they came from Hamburg, Germany, too, where we didn't bomb Germany. It's a little bit...
I'm glad we didn't.
I'm glad we didn't. There's some very good people there. Great strudel. But the point is that I think that you go to war for more causes than just land acquisition or something like that. There's something larger at foot. And when we were attacked on 9/11, and I lost a very dear friend of mine, I knew we had to respond. I knew we live in a very dangerous world.
So was that the only response we could have had?
But that was the Afghan
war.
That was the Afghan war impetus, not necessarily the Iraqi.
Yeah.
Okay, but
they should have flooded with spies, right, and found out where the stuff was. Because when they went in 91, they found nuclear weapons development that was much further along than intelligence thought. So come around to 01 and 02, the Western intelligence all thought that they had built it back up. I think they should have flooded the place with spies, found out where it was, bombed it, and left Hussein with it. I think they should have went in and bombed whatever they wanted on Hussein, but never take the man out of power.
That's what we did in 1990. Yeah. That's what we did.
They should have just left him there. I didn't want to go in 03 because I never heard an after-war plan articulated. There never was one. I said, what are they going to do after they rip this guy out? How are they going to govern this country? They never enunciated. Rumsfeld, none of them ever enunciated after-war plan. I said, what are we going to do?
So,
in we go.
So how did we get from Joe Biden 2 years ago saying that the crowning achievement of the Obama administration would be the peaceful departure from Iraq?
Which is opportunism. Right.
And within 2 years, it's a complete meltdown.
Yeah, well.
Well,
the reality is, it's a bigger picture because it's not just Iraq, it's Syria. And remember when everything was creeping up on Obama and he was sinking in all the scandals, and then he decided that it was the 16th chemical warfare attack in Syria that was the red line?
Yeah.
And when he stepped forward and said, we're going to put our flag in the sand and we're going to settle this,
right,
took it to a UN vote, and not a single country voted with America.
Yeah.
And then suddenly, well, it wasn't his red line, it was the human race's red line.
Oh, no.
But what we did over there
was... He did the moonwalk better than Michael Jackson.
Yeah, and this goes back to the whole thing about gun control, where we're shipping arms to everybody around the world and not doing background checks. Maybe we should have done background checks on the guys in Syria, because the guys we gave guns to are now the same guys that are heading down Iraq right to the oil fields.
Well, yeah. These ISIS guys are capturing American assets. And the ones in Libya are the same thing in Libya.
Artillery pieces.
Well, a lot of it's coming from Libya. It's suspected Chris Stevens was doing in Benghazi was recollecting arms that we had given to the Libyan rebels and shipping them through Turkish ships, through Turkish ports over to Syria.
I just don't want to be around when they're learning to fly the F-16. I'm sorry. I feel pretty good in Reading, Connecticut.
Yeah. No, I mean, it is a mess. It is a mess. But I think that it's been mishandled by this administration. I do feel, and I'm not going to walk away from it, after 9/11, I felt as if we needed to have a robust response to what happened, because we saw 3,000 of our fellow citizens slaughtered on our streets.
So
So, and you got to respond.
We needed to do Afghanistan.
So, we did Afghanistan, and I did not, but I'll live by it. I don't say I voted for the war before I voted against it.
That line's already taken.
I know that I had a vote. I was in favor of going into Iraq. I was because it was a state sponsor of terrorism, and the Bush doctrine was if you are involved in international terrorism or a sponsor and harbor terrorists, we're coming after you.
So when the president gave his speech yesterday or today, whatever it was, and he said, won't put boots on the ground, what does that mean to you? Won't put boots on the ground.
What he's talking about there is there's a difference between putting divisions in combat and doing like a Schwarzkopf, you know, zip across the desert and trying to mop up this entire army. What he's saying is by not putting boots on the ground, he's going to have a defensive force come in there to defend this $1 billion embassy complex that we have there. But we're not going to take aggressive military action.
Here's what intrigues me so much is people are sitting there focused on, oh, okay, well, that must mean he's not going to put U.S. military troops in harm's way over there. 70% of the forces that are fighting in combat in the Middle East right now are mercenaries, like Blackwater. They're hired. They're hired people. They're not U.S. military personnel. Yeah. So when he says, I'm not going to put boots on the ground, okay, no, but you're going to go hire mercenaries to go do the deed. So I just think it's hypocrisy. It's doublespeak. Nobody's talking about that. And I think that's the real story.
So from your point of view and Ron Paul's point of view,
yeah,
you'd say okay on Afghanistan, but absolutely not on Iraq back in 2001, 2002.
No, I'd say 100% no on either of them.
Okay. Let me follow that up then. So when something like 9/11 happens here, what should America's response be if it's not going to be attacking the country out of which that harbored these terrorists that came and did it?
Well, when you say harbor the terrorists, I mean, terrorists are being harbored pretty much in every country in the Middle East right now, right?
Okay, let me ask the question again. What, after 9/11, you're Ron Paul and the, you know, which is a very popular view, what response would you have?
I think I would have gone after Osama bin Laden, not bombed an entire country.
Okay, well, do you know what Tora Bora is?
Yeah.
It was a mountain complex that Osama bin Laden was in. We bombed the crap out of that.
Right.
And we could have done that without 100,000 troops, probably.
Okay, but
$1.7 trillion later.
Okay, but I mean, I think that's what Donald Rumsfeld's approach was. Light, special forces,
It wasn't enough in Tora Bora.
It wasn't. He got away in Tora Bora, but I think...
Because he didn't put troops on the ground.
Okay, fine, but I'm saying, I think that was the initial response. Not to put words in your mouth, but you would be okay with that initial response, go after that terrorist and try to mop up other terrorists around the world, but not have a full-fledged nation-building. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Right. When you take a look at these nation-building attempts,
By the way, Maliki
is a horrible ally.
The phone number here is 438-2003. If you want to add to this,
why were the U.S. troops? Why did the U.S. troops leave? Among other reasons, we wanted to get them out. Some wanted to get them out, but they couldn't sign an agreement with Maliki. Right?
It was a use of forces agreement.
Right.
Status of forces.
And what was his contention? If they stay, they're going to be subject to liability.
Yeah. Meaning, if you get in a firefight and you happen to,
it was unacceptable
to
accept anything from him. We should have kept
the guy in Afghanistan.
We should have kept the guy in
no matter what.
You know, Karzai is worse than Afghanistan. These people were helping.
Take advantage.
The nation building stuff has to stop.
Well, and the real tragedy with Osama bin Laden, in my opinion, is that the Pakistani guy that rolled over and found the guy and
the doctor
turned him over to us. He's now doing hard time in prison while we're still giving billions of dollars of aid to Pakistan, and you wonder why our foreign policy is so screwed up. It's right there.
No, I mean, if we could all turn back the clock, I think your response, and if you said Ron Paul, that's his response, light special forces, go after Osama bin Laden and his network, but not go in there and build 20,000 schools and try and win the hearts and minds and all that stuff, because these people are all nuts, and you can't. They want to kill each other. There's nothing you can do about
it. It's the graveyard of empires, right?
Yeah.
It's traditionally it is.
The British went in there. The Russians went in there, and I'm forgetting someone. There's someone like Alexander the Great went in there and got his head.
Yeah, not so great.
Yeah. So... I don't disagree with what you say. I think you're probably right. If we could turn back the clock and do that.
Can we pivot to the border?
I think we should. Yeah, I do want to talk to you a little bit about the Tea Party and this Cantor. Can I go to that?
Please.
David Brett beats Cantor.
Brett.
Dave Brett. Now, is Brett going to win that seat?
He should.
Big time.
He should.
Okay. Next one. McDaniel is going to knock out that old guy Cochran in Mississippi.
Yeah.
If he does, is McDaniels going to win that Senate seat?
You know, he's got a good shot at it. Why not? It's a Republican
Well, I'll tell
state.
You why not. Because if Cochran is a Republican candidate, he wins it. He wins it. He's an incumbent.
Yeah.
Okay, that's so you guys are causing problems here. Now, follow me.
There's lots of problems to be caused.
Okay.
That's correct.
In Delaware, you had the same thing last cycle. There was you had that little young girl who's a witch.
who
you guys got
who was also targeted by the IRS.
O'Donnell or something like that?
Yeah, Christine O'Donnell.
She's a cute witch.
They love that stuff.
Okay.
That's our problem?
No.
Talk to the people in Delaware. Don't talk to me about it.
Here's the problem. You have a Tea Party back candidate that knocks off... Hold on, let me finish.
Right.
Tea Party candidate that knocks off a somewhat popular yet moderate Republican... And okay, you feel good, you won the primary, but then you lose the seat to the Democrats. Same thing may have happened in Nevada. We had Harry Reid in our crosshairs, and then we get this Tea Party back candidate who wins the primary, and then Harry Reid of all.
You're lost in the weeds, Marty Heiser.
Well, I'm just telling you.
You're so lost in the weeds.
Okay.
Listen.
But then we got to talk about it here. Can we get a shot of this
Let
guy?
Me respond to that very
this
quickly guy. And succinctly.
No, I'm rolling on. I get on a roll. You can't stop me.
Well, you're asking.
Tom Foley, he's going to be the candidate for governor. He might be a moderate Republican, but we need you Tea Party guys to get behind him. That's what I'm saying.
Great.
And then someone like this.
You won't get anything solved.
This guy from Wisconsin, he might not be quite as conservative as you want, but if he's the standard bearer for the Republican.
Scott Walker's awesome.
Okay. All right. But how about Foley? You're going to work with Foley?
Yeah, I suppose.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's on TV.
God.
Right. Okay. Now tell me.
Well, you know what?
He raises an excellent point.
No, he does a jaundiced vignettes on what's going on across the country.
Dude, jaundiced vignettes built this show to where it is.
Everybody loves to go to Christine O'Donnell.
The fact is this.
Please. The Republican Party has drifted away from the principles it's supposed to run on. There are some very bad actors in leadership positions. They must be taken out, both sitting senators and congressmen and ones in leadership. And we take on the toughest challenges in the country, and you are not going to win them all. But the good news for us is we don't have to. The establishment has to win every single one, because we're coming, and we get them one at a time.
Okay, so let me just follow that up. So you're saying, like in Delaware, if we look in Delaware, that moderate who was holding that moderate Republican that's holding said he needed to go, even if it meant we have a 10 times worse Democrat. At least the mantle's been thrown down. The stew is getting cleaned up.
They have to go. They have to go.
Yeah, but even if it means like a
absolutely,
like if you have a candidate
absolutely,
for governor,
Marty. The establishment realizes we're serious.
Okay, great. Listen, this is your day in the sun.
That's the fight.
Okay. The point is, though, like with Malloy, like we got with Malloy running for governor. Let's just say he's the Republican candidate.
He's not. Malloy's the Democrat candidate.
Foley. Let's say he's the Republican candidate for governor, and he's running against Malloy. Let's say Foley, in a moment of weakness, didn't defend the First or Second Amendment quite
There's
as well.
There's plenty of grassroots people working for Foley.
Okay,
no
I'm just saying, but we need more than that. We need you guys to get behind them. If this is the
They're
best
job
we
them.
Got, okay.
What do you want?
But don't pull a Delaware on us or in Connecticut.
That's not absolutely.
Yeah, wait a second.
There's
the
no
2010
comparison.
Election was a Tea Party revolution.
And we won most of the races.
There's a lot of Tea Party guys and women in the House right now that are wreaking havoc with the establishment.
Good.
And you've named a handful of losses. So on balance, the Tea Party...
Mostly the moderates.
Ted Cruz is a rock star
On the other hand, the Tea Party has to grow up a little bit. Because he's right. If they win, if we're giving more to the Democrats,
why?
If we don't win the Senate in 12,
hold on one second,
in 14,
you are telling us that all our candidates have to be perfect.
No,
when all of the establishment stink.
I'm just saying the victory against the establishment has to be a little bit.
We won more than they did. The moderates lost all over the place.
Can you bring some sanity to all this? What's your question?
Well, I guess I can try. You finally brought it back to Connecticut, so thank you. I know the other is important, but let's...
Hey, we were this far away from settling the whole Middle East thing, but we had to move on.
Last week, our Republican Town Committee in Richfield had a fundraiser. Who did they honor but our superintendent of schools?
And our Olympian, Tucker West. Thank you very much, but go ahead.
Pardon?
Tucker West, Ridgefield's own Olympic luge team member, handsome guy, you know, Mr. America, was also honored at the event. But go ahead.
Okay, but that's not what made the paper, so I'm taking from what the paper said.
Okay.
You know, here's a person who the Republicans seem to think highly of, might be fine, except if you bring it back home, as I usually do, she's a staunch supporter of Common Core, and to keep her, and she wasn't retiring, folks, I'll leave that as...
Okay, so let me just explain for the vast viewing audience what you're talking about. The Ridgefield Republican Town Committee had a fundraiser, and they honored Deb Lowe, who was a retiring superintendent of the Ridgefield school system. As it turns out, the search committee couldn't find a replacement, so she agreed to serve for an additional year. And your point is
that amazing.
Your point is that the Republicans in Ridgefield should not have honored Deb Lowe because she's a supporter of her Common Core, and you think that's a bad thing, right?
Yes, and the town rewarded her now, and as a member of the finance committee, you're giving her an extra $50,000. You know what? Will we ever learn?
All right.
Your lovely conversation.
Okay. Thanks. We did go from, you know, world problems right down to...
Someone's got to do it.
Okay, but no, I don't mean to put you on the spot, but that's
I'm not
the
on
rub.
The spot.
Okay.
The rub is that you're making an unfair comparison.
Okay, tell me where I'm
Because on. The moderate Republicans lose all over the country. They lost all over the country in 12. And a couple of Tea Party people lose, and that's their point. It's propaganda. The media does it. They're trying to say the Tea Party's candidates are losers because they find a couple that actually lost.
Well, those are two pretty big ones.
I don't understand. When the moderates lost all over the place, point it all at them.
Well, no,
it's ridiculous.
I'm not
Do you know what the scorecard looked like?
The thing that I'm worried about is that if you had this sort of conservative litmus test, we could potentially
another loaded term.
Okay.
How about you stand on the principles that the Republican Party is supposed to have been standing on for the last 100 years, since the 1912 election when William Howard Taft came out and reset the party on conservative principles? So it's 100 years they're supposed to. And these people get up and start talking about how great big government is. Half of these Republicans talk about, oh, those are good programs. Well, that's baloney.
Okay.
Limited government's the answer. Constitutional government, 10th Amendment. More of these issues that are handled in Washington should be handled back in the states. That's what this whole thing is about, returning power back to the states, limiting federal power. It is a very limited federal government that was created in the Constitution with enumerated powers. And they've just run roughshod over that. All that stuff should be rolled back. There shouldn't be a federal Department of Education.
Okay, so the Tea Party in Connecticut, bringing it back to Connecticut, who are you guys behind? Who do you want to see get elected? Where are you at?
For which race?
McKinney Foley. Let's go with that. It looks like, our buddy.
Foley over McKinney.
Our buddy Bowden, you might have seen this in the Connecticut Post this morning. But Mayor Bowden bows out. He cites a lack of funding.
Yeah.
And do not
vote for his ex-running mate for Lieutenant Governor.
Lieutenant Governor, it was Heather. What Heather?
Heather Summers.
Heather Summers.
She was at
my house. I kind of liked her.
Well, she was great. She had made an agreement with him, and as soon as the convention over, she backed out, took her money, and left.
But she had like a big pile of money, and his pile.
Well, she was close.
But the pile of money would have done it.
So she's running independently as Lieutenant Governor. So we could end up. Day after election with Foley as governor and that lady is a lieutenant governor.
Yep.
But you say don't vote for her. Who do you want to vote for? Wells? Is that the
anyone else?
No, Penny Bakayaki.
I'm not even registered Republican, so I can't vote.
David Walker.
So in Connecticut, who do the team... Okay, let's go. McKinney, Foley.
No McKinney. No, the gun vote. Yeah.
Okay, the gun vote. But Foley didn't have to vote on the gun vote.
Yeah. Well, McKinney stepped up and co-sponsored the bill. He made a big mistake. They don't draw any difference between a constitution and just any old other bill that people might find distasteful.
What if I come to you and say, you know, I've got quotes from Foley who says that, you know, in light of what happened in Newtown, I think we need to really revisit these laws on background checks, and I'd be in favor of that to have common sense gun laws. What if I gave you a quote on that? Would that negate support for Foley?
Not with me. You leave it to the leave it to the gun rights groups, the Second Amendment groups. You know, background checks should be conducted.
Okay, my point is political. Yeah. What you just said there, though, could hand Malloy another 4 years in the governor's mansion. It could.
Why?
Because if the Second Amendment gun right folks say, you know what, Foley isn't quite as pure as we want him to be on that.
Yeah,
he wasn't in a position where he had to vote on it, but he said some things, we've got him on tape, whatever, and then we're not going to come out and support Foley. Great. Then you got another 4 years of Malloy. Wouldn't that be terrible?
Ultimately, you get to the answer you need, which is liberalism is a fraud and a failure. And it's failing all over the country. It's failing in all the poorest cities in the country have been run by Democrats for decades, some forever. Ultimately, if that's what the American people need to see, to finally understand, we'll get there. What can I tell you?
Okay,
I wish it was different.
Well, you can tell
I hope Foley wins, but if they're going to do that, and then the people will finally see what they've wrought. Liberalism—we're up against a party that's a fraud. The only way they can succeed in winning elections is lying.
That's true.
All right.
Or suppress the other party with
when
the
people
the
get when the people get their heads out of the shopping malls and actually look and see what's being done to them, the Democrat Party will be vanquished from the political landscape. Until then, they'll keep eating the lies that are being fed to them.
I agree with you on all that.
Well,
but I'm saying if it comes down to Foley and Malloy, for the
vote,
love of God,
you vote for
Foley.
Yeah.
And all you guys got to come
said
out.
He's supporting.
Yeah. No, he's
for 10 minutes.
Minutes.
He said he's supporting Foley.
Right.
But and every time you say, "Oh, you got to support Foley," he says, "I am." He's supporting Foley.
Killing
okay.
Me. You're killing
I want
me.
More than support. I want support like
what about love?
McDaniel. I want love. I want you to embrace him.
Hey, listen.
He's not
right.
A big Tea Party group anyway in Connecticut. He said, don't beat him up too
bad.
They're big, but they're not. You're not Mississippi Florida.
No,
it's very under
off the radar.
Boom, they come off.
Jim Himes cancels speaking engagements when he knows that Bob McGuffey is going to show up. He just does. He turns around and runs.
He saw me at the parade and his face dropped the other day, last Saturday.
Well, I don't know. I really, you get up, you go to work, play a little golf, try to get your mortgage paid, try to get your kids through school. You don't obsess on this stuff. But I don't think I'm the only one that has a really sinking feeling that this country is not headed in the right direction.
I think the better question is, maybe for Tea Party nationally, is fine, you challenge the primaries. However they come out, they come out. I mean, they have the right to do that.
Yeah.
But, and I think this happened with Romney, they stayed home on election day.
No, we didn't.
He had, well, maybe you didn't, but he got less votes than McCain got.
Yeah, he did.
So those Tea Party, that's what they can't do. You can't, that's what I mean by growing up a little bit. You can't run, you can't say we didn't win, we're taking, we didn't get Newt, we're taking our ball and going home.
Yeah.
You got to beat the other side.
I don't know any Tea Party people that didn't vote for Romney, really. I don't know of any, and mostly, believe me, they held their nose, but they went ahead.
Yeah.
They went ahead.
Yeah.
I mean, the one thing you had to say for Romney, and we don't like his politics, what a good man.
Yeah.
And you knew his biography. He's a solid citizen. He is a good man. There were so many good anecdotes in his life story. He would have been a good man to have in office from that the perspective. A moral and ethical man, if there ever was one, and a compassionate one. So on that basis, it wasn't hard, to vote for him, even though his politics were weak.
And yet the people chose Barabbas.
Yeah.
Well, he got 3 million less votes than McCain.
Yeah.
So no,
but I mean,
away.
That was a tactical win on Obama's part. They had a couple of football fields full of telemarketers in Chicago from 08 that they only shrunk a little bit, never shut down. I was watching the articles on that stuff. They were pointing into all the swing states, and they were organizing for 4 years, and they were getting people out there, and they had the money to do it as if the election was tomorrow, and that whole thing was laid out there just in the swing states. And once 12 came around, they were full bore dialing out of Chicago, organizing in the field, and they drove new voters out. It was a tactical win by Obama. It certainly wasn't a strategic
plus the economy in the state that one of the states that put him over the top, Ohio, was turned around by the guy who should be on the ticket in 2016, John Kasich.
Yeah.
And that benefit, I like Kasich.
Yeah.
And that benefit.
This is what I'm that's the attitude. It's the, of course you want Kasich.
He was throwing roses at big government last week.
Because he took Medicaid money.
But he embellished it even further. Yeah.
But
he won't fight the fight.
You're like.
So the hot topic in the fall election is going to be immigration. Every day, thousands of kids are being dumped across the border. We have a refugee crisis. I pose a question to you.
I'm pretty sure the governor of Texas is coming to bear on that. today.
I mean, yeah, but that's only a piece of the border, right? You got California, you got...
I saw TV, they're taking people across on jet skis. Have you seen this? These coyotes are taking them across on jet skis.
Let me give you an insight.
All right, here you go. Hop out. Let me give you an insight on immigration. Please.
There is more bipartisan agreement on various parts of the immigration challenge than anybody realizes, okay? Yeah. There are so many things you could tee up, like giving every single graduate student who gets his degree a green card right away, keep him in the country, all those kinds of things. Secure the border. You'd get agreement on that. Yeah. The problem is... that the Democrats hold out completely. They will not do any individual bill on an immigration problem whatsoever. They won't speed the lineup or anything else because they know if you pick off all the bipartisan stuff, you'll just be left with normalizing the illegals that are in here, and then nothing will get done on them. And they want them for the votes. They want 10 million more Democrat voters, and that's what it all comes down to. So they hold the whole thing hostage under this rubric of comprehensive immigration reform because they want those voters in the end. And they won't do all the logical things that their members individually would vote for. You'd get 220 votes plus in the House for most of the immigration problems, speeding up the lines and controlling borders and certainly giving good graduate students here the green cards, all that good stuff. But they want that amnesty because they want 10
Does
million more.
Does that change if the Republicans win the Senate in November?
I don't know. Too many of them right now believe that they're going to pick up Hispanic votes if they do the amnesty. It's ridiculous.
You're calling it amnesty. Yeah. What's your definition of amnesty?
Well, giving the illegals that are here now ultimately citizenship.
Ultimately. Yeah. So
well, you know what? Be fine with me. 25 years, you can't vote. Do something. I'm not going to have them vote tomorrow and vote Democrat. That's what they want.
But not tomorrow. Tomorrow is right.
Not
but
5 years either.
That McCain got 40, I mean, Bush got 44%. Yeah. Of the Hispanic vote.
Yeah.
Romney was down
Good
to 27. So this is hurting the Republican Party.
And no, it's not.
You know what?
Bush just had good politics. He spoke Spanish. He knew how to talk about it. Stupid Romney didn't. That's the whole difference.
Yeah, but here's the thing. It's one thing to say if you got here a year ago, 2 years ago, 3 years ago. But for the people that have been here 25, 15 years, you know what? We screwed up. We screwed up. Reagan gave amnesty too. He saw it as an impossible problem. You messed up.
Republican Reagan actually gave and Reagan amnesty big.
Republican and Democratic presidents
and he
have not enforced that border for 20 years. And you got to say, what?
I mean, they all should be voted out of office. Listen,
but it's
there's
too
a law.
What are you going to do with the people? You're going to keep them in limbo?
I don't
you're
care
not
what
deport
you do.
Them.
No.
Then you have to do something
you
under the law about
You don't have to give
them
the right to vote and make them full citizens.
How do other countries deal with that?
You can do it in 10 years. Over 10 years,
no, I'd rather
with a
20.
Fine, go to the end of the line.
Yeah, go to the end of the line.
Go to the proposal.
Go to the end of the line. Whenever you get to the front of the line, I don't care.
I think there's a compromise bill. Like you're saying, there's bipartisan support for
a
lot of this stuff.
He's right.
If the Democrats thought that the illegals in here were going to vote Republican, you'd have a cell of trains going to the borders. Chuck Schumer would be there giving them free passes.
I believe we do have that right now.
Yeah, give me a break.
There's small children.
Let's not get confused what this is about. This is about a permanent majority for the Democrats utilizing the illegals here.
All right. I still think there's some bipartisan. She's saying you're speaking too loud.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
We have a guy's ears are bleeding in there. But
immigration reform is dead.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not going to happen this time around. But I think if the Republicans take over in 14 in the Senate, I think they could craft
Obama's
something.
Not going to sign it.
Well, no, I'm not signing it, but we can pass it. Yeah. We can pass them in the House. You know, that will be comprehensive. Because I believe, I think we're a nation of immigrants, and I think there's something we can do.
Yeah, there is.
Short of what you're
there
talking
is.
About.
And if these people had good intent, they would pick the pieces of immigration problems and they would solve some of these immigration problems, just like they should have done with health care with pre-existing exclusions. Okay. They should have solved that. Instead, it goes comprehensive because that allows socialism to come in. It's the same game over
lightning
here.
Lightning round. Dave, you always have some interesting tidbits. Go through them rapid fire.
No, when President Obama was running for his first term, he said, he was giving a stump speech, and he said, my vision for America is to have a domestic police force as big and as powerful as the U.S. military. And everybody looked at each other and thought, what is this, like a police state? Does he want Nazi Germany? Does he want, you know, East Germans? I mean, what is he, Russia? What's he looking for? And then here you roll the videotape forward about 6 years. The Department of Human Services now, Homeland Defense, has 240,000 full-time workers. a budget of $61 billion and sub-agencies that include the Coast Guard, Customs and Border Protection, Secret Service, Transportation Security, the TSA, Federal Emergency FEMA. There are currently 69 branches of the government with law enforcement capability. What we have at this point is a militarized America. And when you see, even the U.S. Patent Office this week came out and ruled against the Redskins. I mean, that's politicizing. That is, you know, weaponizing another branch of the government.
The economy is not doing great. Unemployment is up. We can't control our borders. The Middle East is blowing up after we spent $2 trillion and 4,500 American lives there. And what are the Democrats busying themselves with? The logo on a football team. Or I believe they had Dr. Oz up there. Something about he's emphasizing a diet pill too much.
So
it's all, you know, the war on women.
So
that's what's going on. This is what these Democrats are busying themselves with when, you know, it's not a good time.
Right, and as events unfold and we see what's going on with the government where a hard drive is conveniently lost. Oh, and it was only her hard drive that was lost, nobody else's.
No, it was six others.
Well,
they also had multiple communications with the White House just prior to targeting my friend here in the Tea Party.
All of this is going to...
Personally.
You watch. All of this is going to gradually start to make Snowden look like a patriot, right? He's a whistleblower, and all the laws have been, at least on the surface, changed to reflect what he sounded the alarms bells. I always said he'll be known as the Paul Revere of our era, one if by landline, two if by mobile. I mean, the guy was right on top of it.
He was. I'm telling you. I mean, all this of James Rosen, you know, he's a conservative news reporter from Fox News. Who do they tap? James Rosen's phones they tap, and they tap his parents out on Staten Island for good measure. I mean, all this stuff, you know, sometimes you guys think sound like conspiracy wackos.
It's supposed to be.
Until you find out, it's all true.
It's not a conspiracy. It's coordinated action.
Coordinated action. I mean, you know, it's like, oh, what you know, what's going on? Final thoughts.
My outrage of the week was going to be the Redskins patent being canceled because I was in fear that the NAACP would lose their trademark.
I'm half Irish.
Yes.
When the NAACP. That's from a friend of mine.
Look at Macguffie. He's so mild mannered. Do you want to call this guy a fighting Irish?
But
I mean, that's
Scottish.
Derogatory.
I'm a fighting Scottish.
Oh, they're even worse. What about the
NAACP?
Irish, the English. I forget.
What about the NAACP?
Oh, it's awful.
Terrible derogatory. But here's my outrage of the week. It was replaced by Senator Chris Murphy. Proposing an increase in the federal gas tax, with Connecticut being the third highest gas tax in the country at 67.7 cents a gallon. He wants to raise the federal gas tax up to 12 cents a gallon.
That's great. So you both,
right on, Senator Murphy.
Chris Murphy, that's what he sent you to Washington to do. You raise the Connecticut state tax on gas as much as you possibly can.
And you ran against a moderate.
Go to Washington.
The Democrats are doing for Connecticut what they did for Detroit. It's just the way it is.
Yeah, do you like Detroit? Okay, final words.
I don't have any more final words for you.
He's done. You beat him up.
I didn't beat you up. I think it's good to have a clearing of the air and stuff like that. And I guess all I can say is congratulations on that victory. I mean, that thing with Cantor was unbelievable.
It's one of many.
And you got to promise me that you're gonna win in Mississippi. We have a New York Times reporter. You
take
get the final 20 He'll seconds. Take us out, reporter.
I've missed the entire show. I just came in, but I see your panel. I see Dave, and I hear you talking.
See, that's our only hope. Many liberal Democrats take drugs, and they fall asleep in front of the TV.
What he's saying is he's been enlightened now. It's beautiful.
All right, New York Times contributing reporter, thank you for that insight. My advice to you is put down the drugs and tune in next time. When we'll see you next week. Good night.
Tell them to meet us at Pippa's. Call them back. Yeah.